Parents are asked to both supervise and children. Please be respectful and quiet throughout the ceremony. Welcome to the Australian War Memorial's last post ceremony. My name is Sharon Bell, and joining us this evening in the Royal Australian Navy is Captain Ashley Papp, former captain of HMAS Canberra III. Today we commemorate the 80th anniversary of the sinking of HMAS Canberra. HMAS Canberra was one of two 10,000 ton county-class heavy cruisers ordered by the Australian government in 1924. Constructed in Scotland, she commissioned at Clydebank on the 9th of July 1928, 2 months after her sister ship HMAS Australia, and she sailed for Australia in December. At the outbreak of hostilities in September 1939, Canberra began patrolling and escorting home waters and the Tasman Sea. In 1940, she carried out escort and patrol duties in the Indian Ocean, rescued survivors of the SS Port Brisbane, and was involved in a number of searches for surface raiders. When war broke out with Japan, Canberra was berthed in Sydney Harbour, with more than 175,000 miles of wartime operational steaming to her credit. She continued the role of escort cruiser, undertaking convoy duties around New Guinea and operations in Malaysian and Japanese waters. At the end of May 1942, she lay at anchor not far from the cruiser USS Chicago on the night of the Japanese midget submarine attack on Sydney Harbour. Captain Frank E. Getting, RAM, assumed command of Canberra in June 1942 and joined Task Force 44, a group of warships from the US Navy and the RAM. In early August, Canberra escorted a landing force consisting mainly of US Marines to Tabagi in the Eastern Solomon Islands and screened its landing. The screening force encountered no initial resistance, but in the darkness of the early hours of the morning of the 9th of August, it was surprised by a determined group of seven Japanese cruisers and a destroyer near Saba Island. As the lead ship, Canberra received the full force of the Japanese barrage, hit 24 times in less than 2 minutes. 84 of her crew were killed, including Captain Frank Getting. In the darkness and confusion, the attackers wreaked havoc before withdrawing. The cruisers USS Quincy and USS Vincennes were sunk. The destroyers, USS Ralph Talbot and USS Patterson, were damaged. The USS Astoria was so badly damaged that it eventually sank. The next day, USS Selfridge fired 263 5-inch shells and 4 torpedoes into Canberra. But the stubborn Canberra refused to sink, until a torpedo fired by USS Hellet administered the final blow. Canberra sank about 8 a.m. on the 9th of August, 1942. The United States Navy Baltimore-class cruiser USS Canberra was later named in her honor, the only American warship named for a foreign warship or a foreign capital city. Today, we remember HMAS Canberra and the Battle of Saba Island. We pay our respects to the men and women commemorated here on the Roll of Honour and to the survivors who returned home. We warmly welcome the family of electrical artificer first class Ernest Harrison, whose story will be told shortly. We also warmly welcome Ms. Alex Gowan, Vice President of the Naval Association of Australia, ACT, Mr. John King, President of the Returned and Services League Australia, ACT Branch, and Dr. Catherine Sperling on behalf of the Australian War Games. We welcome the veterans who have served, those who are still serving, and the families that love and support them. We acknowledge the members of RSL and Services Clubs Association, RSL Victoria, and RSL Queensland who are watching the broadcast of this ceremony across Australia. During this evening's ceremony, wreaths will be laid at the base of the pool of reflection by family, by visitors to the memorial, and by students on behalf of St. Helens Park Public School in New South Wales. If you are able, would you now please stand and join us in singing the National Anthem.
Dennis Harrison was born about 1902 or 1905 in Sutherland, England, the son of Randall and Mary Jane Harrison. His father was a joiner, while his mother, a laundry clerk for some time. He had an elder brother, Oswald. In 1920, Mary Jane Harrison, Oswald and Ernest migrated from the United Kingdom to Australia, travelling aboard the P&O liner, Manella, arriving in Sydney on the 1st of July. Already possessing some skills and experiences at the outset, Ernest enlisted in the Royal Australian Navy on 9th May 1924, signing on for 12 years of service. He spent his first 2 years at HMAS Service, the Navy's training base in Western Port Bay, southeast of Melbourne. Ernest began learning his craft as an electrical artificer, working on the electrical maintenance of ship's generators and engines. Between 1926 and 1928, Ernest had his first postings of ships, including periods in HMAS Sydney, Adelaide, and Brisbane. In 1927, he married Dorothy May Matthews at Drummoyne in Sydney. The couple went on to have two children, Patricia, born in 1929, and Alan, born in 1931. Ernest was at HMAS Penguin, a naval base and training establishment in Sydney's eastern suburbs, adjacent to Garden Island on Sydney Harbour, for most of 1929, where he earned further qualifications. In January 1930, he joined HMAS Canberra, before returning to Penguin, where he remained until January 1932. Following a posting to the seaplane to tend up HMAS Albatross the following year, Ernest found himself drafted to the heavy cruiser HMAS Australia, in which he served from July 1933 to October 1934. With his 12 years of service complete by May 1936, Ernest signed on for another 5 years. Further periods at Cerberus and Penguin were followed by posting to HMAS Yarra in 1937. By then, he had advanced to Electrical Artificer Class 1 with 15 years' experience serving on a variety of different ships. Over the years of his service, Ernest was always a good character, and he received multiple good conduct badges. This culminated in his award of a long service and good conduct medal on the 9th May 1939 while serving on HMAS Adelaide. With war now looming, Ernest rejoined the heavy cruiser HMAS Canberra on 15 June 1939. At the outbreak of hostilities in September 1939, Canberra was patrolling home waters. In June 1940, under the command of Captain Harold Farncombe, the ship began a lengthy period of service in the Indian Ocean, patrolling and escorting convoys and on the hunt for German raiders. During this time, Ernest extended his service for another 5 years. When Japan entered the war in December 1941, HMAS Canberra was alongside in Sydney. She soon commenced escort duties for ship bound for New Guinea, the Dutch East Indies, and Malaya. Canberra underwent an extensive refit in Sydney between February and May 1942. And was in harbour the night of the 31st of May when Japanese midget submarines attacked. In June 1942, Canberra, now under the command of Captain Frank Edding, took part in a sweep northwards into the Coral Sea as part of the US-led Task Force 44. The previous month, the Japanese had taken control of some key points in the Solomon Islands, establishing air bases, threatening communications between the United States and Australia. In order to best back control of the Solomon Islands, the US 1st Marine Division made a seaborne landing on 7 August 1942, quickly seizing Tulagi and nearby islands, including Guadalcanal. HMAS Canberra was among the screening force covering the Marine landings. At first, there was little Japanese resistance, but trouble was brewing. A strike force of 7 Japanese cruisers and a destroyer was steaming from Revolve with orders to attack and destroy the Allied In the early hours of 9 August, the Japanese arrived on Sago Island and took the Allied ships by surprise. Canberra was patrolling between Sago Island and the northwestern tip of Guadalcanal, along with other US Navy ships, when 1:45 AM flares lit up the darkness. Two radar-equipped US destroyers failed to detect the Japanese warships, which rapidly followed the operation. Both forces launched torpedoes, but the Japanese were the first to engage with their big guns. Canberra, having lost all power, was helpless to respond and was soon struck by 24 heavy shells, turning her into a listing, blazing wreck full of wounded and dying men. It is thought that Canberra's loss of power may have been caused by accidentally being struck by a torpedo from one of the American destroyers. The Japanese pressed home their advantage, sinking three additional American cruisers before making their escape. In one night, the Allies lost four cruisers and suffered the deaths of over 1,000 sailors. HMAS Canberra had 84 killed or died of wounds, and another 109 wounded from her complement of 819. Among the dead was Ernest Harrison. The ship was still afloat in the morning, but was assessed as beyond repair. The Canberra was scuttled and went down in what could be renamed Iron Bottom Sound. Ernest and his young son, Alan, had been writing letters to each other weeks before, including lines of inquiry such as how school and music practice were going, and whether he was being big enough to help his mother. Now the husband and father of two was suddenly gone. A scrap of paper in the family collection survived to give a sense of the Harrison's loss. This is a sad day to remember, the day we all were born. The day we lost your dad is the saddest of them all. Ernest Harrison's name is listed on the Plymouth Naval Memorial and on the roll along with my left, among almost 40,000 Australians who died while serving in the Second World War. This photograph is displayed today by the Pool of Reflection. This is one of the many stories of service and sacrifice told here at the Australian War Memorial. We now remember Electrical Arts Officer, First Class, Ernest Harrison, who gave his life for us, for our freedoms, in the hope of a better world. They have no grave with the cruel sea, no flowers lay at their head. A rusting hulk is their tombstone, a fast on the ocean bed. They shall grow not old, as we are left to grow old. Age shall not weary them, though the years condemn. The going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them.
Ah. please forgive.
We leave you this evening with the words of the memorial stone, Charles Green. Many men lying out there across the air, or in the lowest wealth that lived there, with his poor, tired senses barely working through the fever of his brain, has thought in his last moments, well, well, it's over. But in Australia, they will be proud. Ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys, that concludes the last voice ceremony. On behalf of the director and staff, thank you for visiting the Australian War Memorial today and for your continued support of the memorial's development project. We wish you all